All right. Good morning. How are you? My name is Brian Day, and I'm from the NASA Solar System Exploration Research Virtual Institute. Way too long a name. But I am here today to show you a new product. This is our MoonTrek online portal for lunar mapping and modeling. This replaces the venerable LMMP, Lunar Mapping and Modeling Portal. So this came up this year. And this allows you, using your browser, to view and examine the surface of the moon as seen through the eyes of many different instruments aboard many different spacecraft and do all kinds of really fun, amazing things. So let's take a quick look. One of the things, of course, that you can do is you can zoom, you can pan. So let's zoom in a little and go to, say, oh, this nice crater here, Tycho Crater. And one of the things people will typically want to know when you show them a crater like Tycho is, well, how big is it? That's easy to do. We have a number of tools here. So we can calculate distances by simply drawing a line between any two points. So let's draw a line across the diameter of the crater there. And it should end up telling us there's a nice diameter. Simple enough. Okay, let's go ahead and erase this line. And this time we're going to draw another line. We'll extend it a little bit past the edges though, so we can include the rim. We'll go like so. And now what we have here is an elevation profile. So you can measure the heights of mountains, the depths of valleys. And you'll notice you can export this to a CSV file to do your own analysis. That's also very fun. But as they say on TV, but wait, there's more. One of the real fun things we can do, we have lots of tools here. And this tends to be pretty much everybody's favorite. You can draw a rectangle around any piece of terrain you want and actually generate an STL or OBJ file. So if you have a 3D printer, you can make a 3D print of whatever surface feature you want. These disappear very quickly. So we have a variety of other tools. We'll just look at them briefly. You can do lighting analyses. So you can select, again, you draw a bounding box, select a starting time and end time, increments, and you can see how lighting changes over time, even generate maps of watts per square meter, which is good if you're planning a rover traverse. You can even do electrostatic surface potential, so see what kind of charges are building up on the surface. But where this really gets fun is to change the view. So what we can do here is we'll change our projection into a 3D view. And we can use standard keyboard game controls to go flying. You can fly into the crater itself. And you can even, in those areas where we have NAC coverage, you can drop down and essentially get a rover's eye view. Now, we've never had a rover on the floor of Tycho Crater. What we're doing here, this is nadir pointing, this is directly downpointing imagery from the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter, reprojecting using the digital elevation model. So we can get whatever orientation we want. But the real magic of this is that we have over 700 data layers plus a number of additional features, but many different data layers that are co-registered, and you can layer them on top of each other. So let's take a look at how that works. So we'll switch here to the lunar North Pole. And one of the things that you can see here at the North Pole is you do have those very strong shadows that shift azimuthally as the sun goes around. And those can obscure a lot of really important detail. But what we can do is we can switch our view from the narrow angle camera. And what we'll do here is we'll bring up a laser altimetry view. And you can see there, we pierce the shadows very nicely. Now we can change to a slope map. Again, useful if you're planning traverses. Now, not all shadows are bad. Some of those shadows at the poles represent areas that are in permanent shadow. And those are quite interesting to us as potential sinks for water ice. And so we can go ahead and add layers showing where the actual permanent shadows are. Similarly, we can take a look at, say, average surface temperature from the diviner instrument. Maximum surface temperature. And even water equivalent hydrogen. So the real power here is to be able to look at the same area through the eyes of many, many different instruments. So let's go back here. I'm going to switch to a global map. And we'll take a look at another example. So we're going to fly to this area here, one of my favorite places on the surface of the moon. This is the Marius Hills, one of the most spectacular collections of lunar volcanoes on the surface of the moon. And as you look at that, you are no doubt awed by those spectacular volcanoes leaping out in front of you. Isn't that amazing? Maybe not. But if we change our view again, so let's grab a laser altimetry view. Now you can see how they jump right out. These are very subtle volcanoes. And the reason for that is because of the nature of lunar lava. Lunar basalt is typically very, very low in silica, which means it has a very low viscosity. Typical lunar lava erupted with a viscosity of about olive oil at room temperature. It's hard to build a mountain out of that. So a lot of times we need a little help to tease out these details. Now you can see by the scale bar here, these are not big volcanoes. These are fairly typical of lunar volcanoes. And this got us thinking for quite a while, because wherever else in the solar system we see basaltic volcanism, we find giant shield volcanoes. Here on Earth, we have Mauna Loa and Mauna Kea. On Venus, many large shields. On Mars, the greatest shields of them all, including Olympus Mons. And on the Moon, we just have these little pipsqueaks. What's going on? What's the difference? Well, it turns out, if we do something like generate an elevation profile by drawing a transect right through the volcanic complex, we see something very interesting. We see that, in fact, all these cones are sitting on top of a very, very broad extended shield. The Moon does have shield volcanoes, but they are so low profile that you need special tools like this to tease them out. Now, let's take a look at a completely different view of this same area. So I'm going to load a map. This is a gravity map, in which case orange is high gravity, blue is low. And now what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at when we've loaded these layers. We can load any number of different layers. We can stack them on top of each other. And one of the real cool things we can do is then we can adjust the transparency of layers. So I can bring this down so that we can actually now see the laser altimetry through the gravity map. This allows us to now visualize the now solidified, unerupted plug of magma beneath this volcanic complex, as well as the surface manifestation of the cones on the top of the complex. This means that you can take multiple layers from different instruments on different spacecraft and blend them together in ways that can bring out information that none of these individual data layers would be able to show you. There's a lot of power there. Now, admittedly, this is somewhat of a manual and almost artistic process. And at the end of doing this, there's a good chance that once you've teased out what you want to show, you might want to save that or share that. And it turns out that's very easy to do. You can simply generate a URL. Because this is all browser-based. You don't install anything, you don't buy anything, you just point Chrome at our website. And so once you have generated a visualization, you can generate a bookmark for that, simply a URL. You email that to your friends and colleagues, they just paste that into their browser, it brings up MoonTrek, pans and zooms to your location, loads the layers, adjusts the differences between the layers, and brings up the same visualization that you have. Very powerful. But the most fun is to just go flying. So what we'll do now is we'll switch into the 3D globe mode and again, this uses the standard keyboard game controls. I am not a gamer, so I had to learn these. But it is fun to start flying around. So here we are flying over, here's Schroeder's Valley. This is the greatest sinuous rill on the surface of the moon, a giant channel carved by flowing lava. And then off in the distance here, we see something different. Here we see the Grootheusen domes. These are also volcanoes, but these don't require any amplification. These are silicic. This is made of pasty lava that built steep volcanoes. Why are these different? We don't know. Just one of the mysteries of the moon. So I'll invite you to go to moontrek.jpl.nasa.gov. Also, we have a bunch of our developers back here behind the hyperwall at the table. They will be happy to show you more details and also some of our other portals. We've got this for Mars, we've got it for Vesta, and they're also demonstrating pre-release our VR portal. So you can put on the goggles, and if this didn't make you sick, they will. Thank you very much.